Hi there. Today, I would like to explore with you a little bit more in detail the relationship between physics and finance. As you probably already know, physicists are in high demand in banks and other financial institutes. And that's because physics and finance are much more intertwined with each other than you might think at first. So in this video, I want to show you four physics topics applied to finance. And I'm not just talking about numbers and statistics in general, but real physical concepts and models. Of course, the number of intersections between physics and finance are many more, and we will investigate them in other videos. So if you don't want to miss any updates on this subject, don't forget to subscribe. So let's start with topic number one, entropy. There are different types of entropy, depending on whether you studied in thermodynamics or statistical mechanics or information theory. In any case, entropy is always a measure of disorder and uncertainty. So no wonder that the concept of entropy has also found application in the world of finance, which is, by definition, very uncertain. In finance, when we talk about uncertainty of an investment, we are talking about the risk of the investment. Every investment is kind of a bet. And if we take the risk to bet in something which is very uncertain, then we will also demand a higher payout. Now, to decide whether the expected return from an investment is appropriate to its risk, you should first be able to measure the risk itself. That means you need to express the risk with a numerical value. Well, there are various ways of measuring risk. The best known measure is probably volatility, which is nothing more than the standard deviation. But the use of standard deviation in models, like for example in the asset pricing model, is based on the assumption that the return of the investment is normally distributed, which is not always the case. From this perspective, the concept of entropy as measure of uncertainty is way more general and subject to almost no assumption. And it is actually used, instead of standard deviation, in some of the most advanced financial models. Topic number two, turbulent flows. There are interesting similarities between the behavior of turbulent flows and financial markets. A turbulent flow is, by definition, characterized by chaotic and random movements of the fluid, while financial markets are characterized by the random evolution of asset prices. What causes the random movement in a turbulent flow is the interaction and superposition of many vertical structures within the fluid. These vortices interact with each other, they break down, they merge again, and energy is usually transferred from large vertical structures to smaller ones. This is basically what happens every time you stir a spoon in a cup of coffee. Whenever you mix the sugar, you're actually activating a process of energy transfer from big vortices to smaller ones. And something similar happens also in the financial markets. In this case, the energy of financial markets is financial information. For example, some news about a company. On good news, prices go up, on bad news, prices go down. So price movements are in fact driven by the spreading of information within the market. And this information spreads in the market at different levels, with big sources of information feeding smaller ones. More or less the same way big vortices in a turbulent flow would stimulate smaller vortices with energy. Private investors are here the last link of the chain, consuming the available information. And in a sense, they play the same role as small vortices during turbulent flows. In short, the same way you would describe the velocity of the turbulent fluid, you could describe the time evolution of a stock index. Topic number three, quantum finance. Okay, that's a very new and current topic. Many financial activities, for example, pricing of securities and portfolio optimization, they all require the ability to simulate a range of potential outcomes. These statistical simulations, which could be, for example, Monte Carlo simulations, are computationally very expensive. Probably you already know it. When it comes to statistical simulations, a quantum computer is much faster than a classical computer. Let's say that on a quantum computer, it can take just a couple of minutes to perform a task that would occupy a classical computer for hundreds of years. Now, one of the problems with quantum computing is that it works conceptually differently from classical computing. This means that we won't be able to use on quantum computer softwares that have been written for classical computers. So, when writing algorithms for quantum computers, we'll need to reframe the financial models in terms of quantum principles. For example, instead of using an option pricing model based on the classical random walk, we would need to use a new model based on quantum work. And this is already happening. To enable this shift to quantum computing, experts in classical finance models are already closely cooperating with experts in models of quantum physics. Topic number 4, random walk and stock markets. Okay, this is probably the most famous example of application of physics in financial markets. I've already done an entire video on this topic that you can check out here. In short, in this model, we assume that the stock prices behave like dust particles floating in the air. That means we can apply the concept of random walk or Brownian motion to describe the evolution of financial assets. In other words, the movement of stock prices are driven by some random factors in the market. The same way the movement of dust in the air is driven by many molecules which moves randomly and are invisible to the eye. And that's it for today. If you want to know more about the similarities between physics and finance, you can see other videos on this channel. Thanks for watching, stay tuned, and don't forget to subscribe.